Up Close with Joyce Meyer.
And I still believe there are good things happening.
The popular author and speaker talks about the importance of hope.
We need to believe that good things are about to happen at any moment.
And the most powerful force in the universe.
I can't wait to see what God is going to do today.
On today's 700 Club Interactive. Hi, and welcome to the show. Joyce Meyer has more than 9 million Facebook fans, and more than 3.5 million people follow her on Twitter. She's also an enormously popular speaker and author.
CBN's Wendy Griffith recently visited Joyce at her television studio for a personal look at how this busy ministry leader always manages to keep her hopes up.
Say goodbye to those bad attitudes. It's a new day.
Joyce Meyer is one of the world's leading Bible teachers and authors. Known for her transparency and matter-of-fact style, she's ministered to millions of people through her books, conferences, and her television show, Enjoying Everyday Life.
And now here, I know this is hard to stomach, and don't you turn the TV off.
I sat down with Joyce in her St. Louis studio to discuss her latest book.
You've written over 100 books now, which is incredible. Why a book on hope, and why now?
Well, first of all, you know, I just feel like the times that we're living in are just so hopeless. And I don't know about anybody else, but I am so tired of hearing negative, and just nothing good. And I still believe there are good things happening.
In the book, you talk about the transformative power of hope, and you actually say it's the most powerful force in the universe.
Well, obviously, we know that God is the most powerful force in the universe, but if we follow His example, then we're going to experience a power like we never have before.
Well, Joyce, I just can't help the way I feel. Well, actually, that's just not true.
And you can't expect anything in your life to change if you're going to be saying all the time that you're afraid it's not going to change. Mm. And so we need to believe that good things are about to happen at any moment. I think that allows us to get up every day and live more with a sense of adventure. Kind of like, I can't wait to see what God is going to do today.
You say that hope is a choice.
Right.
How so?
You know, even if you start to feel your mood sinking or something, right away say, Holy Spirit, help me.
Yeah.
He's our helper. Mm. We don't have to just try to do things on our own. Mm. We can ask Him to help us. Help me remember to keep my hope up.
And faith and hope, very closely connected. Why is hope directly proportional to faith?
Well, I think a lot of people are trying to have faith, but they don't have hope. And so let's explain what hope is first. Hope is a happy anticipation that something good is going to happen.
Right.
So how many people do you know that would say, well, I'm believing God for this, or I'm trusting God for that, but they have a totally negative attitude and a negative conversation.
Yeah.
Everything's
down. Their words are not hopeful.
You know, going through, you know, it's just their whole demeanor is down.
Yeah.
But yet they'll say they're trusting God. And so I think that hope is like the springboard to faith. I don't see how we can have real faith if we're not hopeful and expecting God to do His best. Mm. In our life.
Well, because faith is the substance of things hoped for.
Right, exactly. And hope is an expectation of good. Mm. It's not just like, well, I hope something good happens. That's more like wishing, you know. But the Bible kind of hope is an expectation that God is who He says He is, that He is of His Word, and that if we put our faith in Him, something good is going to happen in our life.
You said, too, that even if nothing amazing happens, the fact that you lived with hope for that day makes it a better day anyway.
Exactly. And the thing is the more we talk about our problems, the more we magnify the problems, it's good to learn to look at things with God's perspective.
Joyce says it's a lesson she had to learn for herself.
I know that I sin and miss the mark every day, but I'm not focused on it anymore. I don't go around keeping lists of everything that's wrong with me because I just consider that I'm in Christ. Amen.
We see Joyce Meyer on TV preaching and in the conferences and writing books, but anything we don't know about you that you do for fun?
Well, you know what? I think that rather than just doing something for fun,
yeah,
I think we need to learn to really enjoy everything that we do.
Hmm.
Because I had this attitude for a long time. I'll sure be glad when I get done working, because then I can thus
yeah,
and so.
Sure.
And then it just occurred to me one day, why can't I enjoy this?
Yeah.
And enjoy my home. Don't just live in my home.
Mm.
Enjoy my home. And I really like my morning coffee, so don't be thinking about something that I got to solve over here while I'm drinking it. Why not just sit and talk with God and enjoy it?
She also enjoys a good workout, believe it or not.
I work out 3 times a week, and I do enjoy that.
Mm-hmm.
And
oh, come on. You really enjoy it every time.
You know, once in a while, I'll have a hard day where I'm like, can't wait to get this over with. But I have a great trainer, and honestly, I can tell him, you know what, I cannot stand that exercise.
Mm.
And he'll say, I can find 5 other ways to exercise that muscle. We'll find one that you like. And I appreciate that.
Of all the different things you're doing, the TV and the writing and the preaching, do you have a favorite?
Oh, teaching is my passion. I would like to personally thank you for letting me teach you the Word of God. I enjoy it, and I'm glad to participate in your spiritual growth. Amen?
When I'm in God's anointing and just teaching the Word and seeing how it affects people, that's the call of my life. I love that.
What do you hope readers will take away from Get Your Hopes Up?
I want people to take away that their thoughts and their attitude and their words belong to them, and that they don't have to be led around by feelings or lack of feelings, mm-hmm. that they can actually choose to be led by the Spirit.
Teaching is her passion, and she really, I believe, has touched so many lives. It must be a wonderful thing to break open the Word of God, knowing that there are some people who are really getting into this for the first time, some who are coming deeper, and some who are walking right there with you in the glory of it all. I just think she's an incredible gift to the body of Christ.
Yes, and she hits on a very interesting thing. A lot of Christ followers don't seem hopeful or happy or joyful. And there's been times in my walk where I've struggled with that, and I've said, you know, Jesus, you said you're the bread of life.
Mm-hmm.
And if I come to you, I will not be hungry, nor will I be thirsty. Well, I'm hungry and I'm thirsty. Spiritually, I'm not fulfilled or feeling your presence. And then I realized something that's pretty obvious. I know how to eat. Mm-hmm. I know how to drink.
Yes.
It's not just once and I'm satisfied
once and
forever.
Done, right.
Mm-hmm. You have to continue.
Yeah.
To feed your hunger, to feed your thirst. And it's that continual investment in relationship with Christ. It really is a relationship.
Yeah, and I think that's what people see in Joyce that motivates them is it's so evident in her that she goes to the well daily and drinks fresh water and eats fresh manna and is encouraging all of us to do that. And I think that's why people love, it's why she's written 100 books because, you know, people really take advantage of them. And, you know, it's like that old bumper sticker used to say, if you don't feel close to God, guess who moved? Mm-hmm. Well, I think she's trying to help all of us stay in that close place. Wonderful. Well, up next, she's the artist behind the song Better Off Saving Souls. And there was a time when she needed a rescue.
I remember feeling that my innocence was taken. It was almost like I was just robbed.
We'll hear from gospel music's Sharetta Nicole. That's next. In her short career, Sharetta Nicole has released an album and has won an Urban Inspiration Award. She's a rising star with a bright future who had to overcome a dark past.
My childhood started to get rocky at the age of 8 when I first encountered being molested. I remember feeling that my innocence was taken. It was almost like I was just robbed. As far as me just telling, it wasn't an option. I'd never built that bond with an older sibling or my mother to just share that with, especially not my father. I just remember him not being around as much, and when he did come around, he was drunk, and very abusive to my mother. It just, everything just happened so fast, and my mom screamed for my older brothers to come and help her. So, you know, I'm thinking, what's going on? I run into the room, and my father was kneeling on the right side of the bed, and he had a stroke and died that night. My mother was left to just raise the rest of us. So one evening, while my mother was working the midnight shift, I had got a candle, and I fell asleep with the candle lit in my hand. I woke up, and my bed was on fire. I remember looking over at my sister. I remember us running downstairs to get water to put the fire out, and not thinking to just get up, running to the other room where my niece and nephew were asleep. The house burned down, and later, you know, my niece and nephews were in the house, and they died, 9 months and 1 year old. I felt like a murderer. I would tell myself in my mind, you're so stupid, why didn't you go? And I would have dreams replaying that I did go in a room and get them, and I wake up with feeling that it's true, and it just depressed me even more. After the fire, for my 14th birthday, my mother got me and my twin this huge cake, and I just remember feeling happy, excited, and just loved. I actually think that was like my first cake, to come to think about it. I was just on a high, but then unfortunately, I felt it was snatched away in seconds, because a week later, my mother was kidnapped, taken to a vacant house on the east side of Detroit, shot in the head and killed. My whole world just shattered. You go through so much in life, and you start to feel loved. You start to feel appreciated and wanted, because you just dealt with sad stuff after sad stuff, and then you finally get happy, and then the person that made that moment goes away. In the eighth grade, I met an English teacher by the name of Yvonne Grimet, and I was in her class, and I would cut up bad in her class. She went to her husband, Reverend Grimet, and shared some things with him. And so Reverend Grimet and Yvonne Grimet put together this group of a class where they counsel students that has gone through some hardship. Well, that class ended up being a Bible study. The people around me were so full of life, I wanted to follow what they were following. So I just had to know who this Jesus was. I just felt I need to give it to Jesus, because I couldn't handle it anymore. I'm at my breaking point, I have no hope. So I gave my life to Christ. It's amazing how life before that was so gray. And then when I gave my life to Christ, it was like, it's like I woke up. And that's when my true healing process started. I can't sit here and say, oh, it's great. No, it's painful, because healing is really just letting go, accepting, forgiving, and trusting that God is going to put every crack that happened in the time when your heart was broken to be completely healed. So my healing process was painful, but it was worth it, because I'm whole now, and I'm free, and I can share it with someone and help them. I'm able to take what I've experienced and put it into a song, and just tell the world about God and how good He is.
You know, Joyce Myers was just talking about the significance of hope, of having hope, of believing that good things are going to happen today with God. How do you do that when the kind of things that Sharetta went through happen? You know, so much of it happened when she was a child, and how hard it is for children to process through all of that. And when that happens to any of us, usually those hurts, even though we mask them and kind of stuff them down, they follow us into adulthood. And you know, they impact everything, don't they? They impact the kind of people we hang with, the kind of spouse we choose, the way we deal with our children and other relationships in our lives, and even the value system that we form. But when we cling to God and His promises, you know, we talked about that a few minutes ago as well. What does God say to us? What are His promises to us? What are the things that we can speak back to Him and say, "You said, this is what You wrote. You're my Father. You're the one who will never leave me or forsake me. You're the one who created me with a plan and a purpose in mind." All of a sudden, hope comes rising up out of the darkness of all of the junk that we've gone through, all of the pain that we've endured. And we have a hope and a future. One of the things I find most astonishing about God is His character is defined in Romans 8:28, that all things work together for good to those who love Him. That means that even the pain that Sharetta went through, not because God didn't care or wasn't there, but because we live in a broken world. Not only are we sinners, we're surrounded by people who are sinners, and bad things happen, sometimes to good people. Lots of times to children. But God takes that brokenness if we'll give it to Him, and He makes something good out of it. Today, she's taking that pain of her past, the hurt, and then the hope that she's found, and she's singing about it. God's using her to bring hope to other people. You know, He'll do that with you too. I don't know what you've been through or what your hurt is, but you know, most of us know when there's a little place deep inside of us that's broken and cracked. How do you get to the Romans 8:28 part, the hope part? Well, you take that brokenness and you give it back to Jesus. He already knows it's there. He understands it. He's really the only one who can heal it. And like Joyce said, you have to choose healing. You have to choose salvation with Him. You have to choose to say, "God, I'm in need." There's a humbling process needed in that. But when you're honest and when you do it and when you come to Him, He never turns anyone away. You can't sin too much to separate you from the love of God. But today, if you're looking for that kind of peace and hope and joy in your life, then humble yourself before the Creator of the universe who also created you and say, "God, I am a sinner in need of a Savior. Will You be my Savior today? Will You forgive my sin today? Will You give me a new beginning? And will You take my hurt and my pain and make something that matters out of it?" You see, God is not only able, He's willing. He loves you so much. Just talk to Him like a friend. He's there. He's not just with you, but when you pray that prayer, He's now in you. And He will turn all things to good in your life. Our number is toll-free if you'd like to pray with someone today about a specific need in your life. There it is on your screen, 1-888-777-1999. You can call right now. Andrew?
Thank you, Terry. Well, guys, if you enjoy the stories you see on our show, why not share them with a friend? Here's a few ways you can do that. You can friend us on Facebook or follow us on Twitter. Or just go to our website, 700clubinteractive.com, and there you'll find inspirational stories and a lot more. There's miracle testimonies, daily devotions, and teachings, and you can also sign up to join our weekly email list so you always know what's coming up on our show. Make sure to check it out. Well, coming up, we're going to be praying for you and your needs, but first, a mom and her kids lived on $2 a day until an injury left her begging for food, but see how you made her dream come true. That's after this. Johanna had to feed four children on only $2 a day. So we decided to help this single mom. And today she owns her own business and her kids never have to go to bed hungry.
Every day, Johanna would make her way through this mosquito-infested swamp looking for one thing, mangrove crabs. For an entire day's work, she'll earn only $2.
I really need to go to the mangrove swamp every day. With four kids, there is never enough.
One day, as she was cutting a path through some thick brush, her machete slipped and cut her hand.
Ayúdenme! I started to scream, then somebody helped me get into the canoe.
Joanna paddled 40 minutes to reach the dock near her home.
I went to the clinic and they helped me. My hand was so swollen.
For a week, Joanna couldn't collect crabs to sell, but her children still had to eat.
When my mom could not work, I went to the swamp to look for crabs to make a soup.
Later, Joanna met some folks from Operation Blessing. She mentioned her dreams of having a bakery and making donuts. A few days later, she was shocked when we arrived at her home with everything needed to start that business. Joanna soon realized she was the only one in town selling donuts, and within a few months, she was earning up to $450 a month.
Now I am so happy because my mom has her own business. We don't go without food anymore. Thanks, Operation Blessing, for helping my mom.
Thank you for what you have made possible. We look at Joanna there, rowing through the swamp with mosquitoes and in her efforts to catch crabs. It was a tragic situation. And for all that, she made a couple bucks a day to feed four children. And then she can't even work. But people like you stepped in and made a difference, and we do it every day all around the world, changing people's lives. And it's easy to do. Just join the 700 Club. You can call us at 888-777-1999 or log on to 700clubinteractive.com. And Terry, I remember when I first saw that story, I was so heartbroken for her and what she had to do on a daily basis and how easy it is for people to help someone like that.
Absolutely. And, you know, even when you see the lack of medical care that's available to people, the distance they have to go to find that. I mean, it's just a remarkable opportunity we all have to join hands together and to find a solution. And then in many cases, you know, people are hearing about the love of God that have never been introduced to him before. So very exciting.
Wonderful.
Very exciting.
What we can do. Well, we have received some prayer requests on Facebook. So let's go over to Jessica. Jessica?
Well, thanks, Andrew. Here's one from Dale. This is a real tearjerker. He writes in, our worship pastor lost his dear wife, Mary Beth, to breast cancer this week. She was only 46. Please pray for him, their two daughters, and our church family. Here's another one from Vicky. She says, I'm homeless with two kids. I struggled to keep my rent paid, but I lost my apartment and am now currently homeless. I need a career that understands physical challenges, learning disability, pays enough for us to get a place and keep up the payments. I'm a single mom too. Please pray. And finally, we have one in from Christina. I lost my job today, she writes. I'm overwhelmed. Please pray for me. Well, we're going to pray for those needs, and we're going to pray for you. So if you're watching and you can relate to some of the stories that we have showed today where you said, God, I have prayed, but I'm scared of being disappointed, we want to pray with you today, and we want to pray in faith, believing for breakthrough. Let's go to prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, God, that when we stand on your promises, when we stand on your word, that we will not be disappointed. Father, I pray right now for a special grace for those who are watching this program and they're saying, God, I have been disappointed so many times. I've put my faith out there. I've gone out on a ledge. And every time I feel disappointed and disappointed. Lord, I ask right now that you would give them the grace to trust in you, to not look at their circumstances from an earthly perspective, but just like Joyce said, that they'd begin to see all of their life circumstances through a godly, heavenly perspective, knowing that even when we do not see you working, God, that you are faithful and that we can trust you in being faithful and that you are behind the scenes working on our behalf. Lord, we just pray for the prayer requests that have come in today. Lord, we hear Dale's heart cry for his church family, for this worship pastor who has lost his wife at such a young age. God, in these situations that there's so many questions and wondering where is God and trying to figure out what is your character, what is your will. Father, we pray that you would meet them in their grief. Lord, that they would experience you in a new, tangible way where they will look back and say, the Lord was with us in this time of tragedy. Father, for Christina, who has just lost her job, Father, we pray that you would heal her heart, that you would open doors that only you can open, that you would close doors that only you can close. And finally, for Vicky, Father, you have heard the cries of her heart. And Lord, we pray that you will make a way, that you would make a path in the desert where there seems to be no way. We give this all to you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Andrew?
Amen. Beautiful prayer, Jessica. Thank you. We hope this show has encouraged you today, and we leave you with this scripture from Psalm 33, verse 20. We wait and hope for the Lord. He is our help, and He is our shield. For Jessica and Terry, I'm Andrew Knox. We'll see you next time on 700 Club Interactive. Bye-bye.